Welcome to the New America Foundation. Thank you for coming this afternoon. I'm Peter Bergen. I run the International Security Program here. It's a lot of pleasure that I get to introduce a friend and a longtime friend of New America. Bob Grenier, as I'm sure you know, was station chief in Pakistan at the time of the 9/11 attacks. He oversaw the CIA special forces operations that were that went on in Afghanistan during the overthrow of the Taliban. He negotiated with the senior leadership of the Taliban, which I'm sure he'll explain. You know, history could have been very different. We wouldn't be sitting in this room, and we wouldn't have invaded Afghanistan, or we wouldn't have invaded Iraq if Bob Grenier had succeeded. I mean, you made a very good effort to talk to the senior leadership of the Taliban. If they had handed over bin Laden a few weeks after 9/11, American history would have been different, and to some degree, world history would have been different. So it's a very interesting what if. After he was station chief, Bob Grenier became Iraq mission manager. So I think this was the first time in CIA history where, correct me if I'm wrong, where somebody had been tasked as sort of in this way. And now I think it's pretty routine.
Mm-hmm. I don't know how routine it is, but yeah, there was this, they made it up. Yeah.
So, basically, yeah, Tennant said, "You're the Iraq guy. We're about to invade Iraq. Yeah. You're the Iraq guy."
There's kind of one person, and that was me.
Right. So, yeah. He also, and this is something I just found out today, he headed the farm, which is, of course, CIA's training facility. And he's had a 27-year career in the CIA, very distinguished career. He went on to work in global risk management, including at Kroll. He's currently chairman of ERG Partners. And he's just come out with this new book, 88 Days to Kandahar, a CIA diary, which was just published by Simon & Schuster. So Mr. Grenier is going to give us 20 minutes or so about some of the big stories and big themes of the book, and then we'll open up to Q&A.
Okay. So thank you very much, Peter.
Thank you.
Appreciate the introduction. Our story begins early on a Sunday morning. It was the 23rd of September, 2001. I was sound asleep in my bedroom, which was actually a safe haven, steel doors, bars, the whole works, in Islamabad, Pakistan. I was absolutely exhausted. I'd only been asleep for about 3 hours. And the phone rang. Again. So there was probably more than a hint of petulance in my voice when I picked up the phone and I said, "Hello?" And I was sure it was some GS-12 back in Langley who was going to harass me about something or other. And instead there was a pause at the other end of the line. And a voice said, "Did I wake you, son?" Good God, it's the director. I was not in the habit of being phoned up by George Tenet. And so I did the only thing I could do. I lied. I said, no, Mr. Director, I was just getting up. He said, "Look, we're going to be meeting in just a few hours at Camp David, the Principals Committee, the War Cabinet. And we're going to be considering the war plan for Afghanistan." So the Pentagon is telling us that there are very few military targets in all of Afghanistan. They're going to run out of targets really quickly. We know where all the terrorist training camps are, but they're all empty. The terrorists have all run away. And he literally said, "Do we bomb empty camps?" Now think about this. This is 12 days after 9/11, the worst one-day disaster in American history since Pearl Harbor. And George Tenet, at the center of American power in Washington, D.C., is bypassing the entire chain of command to call me on the phone and say, "What do we do?" If you didn't know we were in trouble before, you knew we were in trouble now. So I gathered my thoughts together and I said, "Well, you know, Mr. Director, I'm not sure we're thinking about this the right way, that this isn't primarily a military problem, this is actually a political problem. And yeah, we're probably going to have to use military means, but they're going to have to be calibrated in such a way as to achieve a political end." What we need at the end of the day is for some responsible political element in Afghanistan to be able to control its territory and deny it as a safe haven for international terrorists. We can probably chase bin Laden and al-Qaeda out of the country, but only Afghans can keep them out, unless we're going to colonize Afghanistan, and that was inconceivable. So he started to walk through it, and he was taking notes and asking me questions, and I said, look, Mr. Director, this isn't going to work. This is taking too much time. Let me just write this all down. So he said, good idea. It was after 11 o'clock on Saturday night, his time, early Sunday morning, my time. He said, the helicopter comes for me at 5 o'clock in the morning to take me to Camp David. Can you get something to me by then? I said, yes, sir, I can. So I drove to the office, banged out an 8-page message in about 3 hours. By this time, my senior lieutenants were in the office. I shared it with them. They gave me some very good advice, made some changes, and sent it off with instructions to Director Tenet's security team that it was to be given to him as soon as he woke up. So he did. He took a look at it. He sent copies to the other members of the War Cabinet, to Rice and to Cheney and to Rumsfeld, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs. And I had no idea what was going on, but they discussed it that Sunday up at Camp David. And the following morning, they met with the president in the Situation Room and briefed him, and he said, done. This is the template going forward. And Tenet said, okay, well, I'll put Grenier in touch with Tommy Franks, commander of CENTCOM, senior military commander, for the war that was to come, and make sure that his battle plan is in line with what we've just agreed. So what was it that we said? Well, as I said before, we said, look, this isn't primarily a military problem, this is a political problem. At the end of the day, we have to have some political dispensation in Afghanistan that will deny the country as a safe haven for international terrorists. And if the Taliban will be that power, then so much the better. If some other faction within the Taliban is willing to push Mullah Omar aside and change policy, then so much the better. But if that doesn't work, and if, as is likely, we have to turn to somebody else, there we have to be very, very careful. Because if we just enter this war as a party with the Northern Alliance, which, as we all know, had been locked in a civil war with the Taliban for years, if we simply come in as a party to a civil war, the Pashtuns, many of whom are now opposed to the Taliban, will recoalesce, most likely, around the Taliban and will make the situation worse rather than better. So Pashtuns have to be a part of the solution. And at the time, I said that with a lot of confidence because we had been working, we the CIA had been working for months, meeting with dissident Pashtun tribal leaders in the south and east of Afghanistan. These were people who had been pushed aside by the Taliban in most cases. Many of them were highly disaffected. Some of them were fighting on behalf of the Taliban against the Northern Alliance. But they were looking for an opportunity to come back into power. They'd been eclipsed. And so after the negotiation that Peter spoke of, I spent about 8 hours in total, two different meetings with Mullah Osmani to try to get him to break with Mullah Omar and to change policy. I briefly succeeded, but not well enough. His agreement to do so didn't survive his return to Kandahar. And so we turned to all these tribal leaders and we said, this is your opportunity. You've been looking for an opportunity to rise up against the Taliban. Well, now when you do it, you'll have the full weight of American military power behind you. But my optimism was misplaced. Almost to a person, they demurred. You survive in Afghanistan by making sure that you come in on the right side of the fight. They wanted to make sure that the Americans were serious. They wanted to see which way this war was going to go before they stuck up their heads and possibly had them cut off by the Taliban. There were only two tribal leaders of any note who were willing to go in on their own and try to foment a rebellion in the Pashtun areas of the country against the Taliban. One was Hamid Karzai. Came up fairly well, thank you very much. and the other was Gulag Sherzai, former governor of Kandahar. And so much of this book is taken up with the story of those two tribal leaders and the improbable effort which ultimately culminated in what we thought was the defeat of the Taliban, the dispersal of al-Qaeda, when Kandahar fell 88 days after 9/11. We can talk about that in a whole lot more detail if anyone is inclined. It's a great, great story, particularly Hamid Karzai. I wouldn't have given a dime for Hamid Karzai's life on many occasions. Shortened my own life expectancy by at least 10 years. I'm absolutely certain of that. But there was another parallel war that we were fighting at the same time. As al-Qaeda was fleeing from Afghanistan, they were fleeing in the first instance into Pakistan. And so we, American intelligence, the FBI, were working hand in glove with the infamous Pakistani intelligence service, the ISI, to arrest these people. And ultimately, they made up a fair proportion of the population of Guantanamo. But with regard to the Taliban, the situation was always a lot more complicated. We can talk about that as well. There were other adventures along the way. These 88 days were a very, very improbable time. And more than anything else, I think we were just lucky. There was a group of Pakistani scientists, nuclear scientists, associated with an organization called Umat-e-Tamiri-Now, the head of which, nuclear scientist himself of considerable renown, was in touch with bin Laden and with al-Qaeda. And there was a distinct fear, a palpable fear in Washington, that he may have provided nuclear materials and possibly, God forbid, even a nuclear weapon to al-Qaeda. That got people's attention. We also had a near brush with war between India and Pakistan in the spring of 2005. And I needn't remind you that these are two nuclear armed states. It was also a very improbable story about the rescue of a group of missionaries, mostly Germans and Americans, who had been arrested by the Taliban before 9/11 and who, again, improbably made good their escape, and CIA with JSOC managed to rescue them in the end. But the victory itself that came on December 7th, 2001, frankly, came too easily. I never, ever thought it would be that easy. I greatly feared at the outset that we would end up like the Soviets and the British before us. And in retrospect, I can say that we didn't fully understand how or why we had supposedly won this war. And therefore, we didn't understand just how fragile this supposed victory was and how easily it could be reversed. And I think there were a catalog of errors that we, as an agency, we as a government, made in those early months and ultimately years after our supposed victory in 2001. And our gaze traveled elsewhere. We went off to Iraq. I myself, as Peter mentioned, went off to become the CIA mission manager for Iraq, spent 2.5 years of my life focused on Iraq. And by the time I came back, focusing once again on Afghanistan and Pakistan, among other things, this time as the head of counterterrorism for the CIA, I went off to Pakistan, into Afghanistan, made an extensive trip in the spring of 2005. And I didn't fully understand it at the time, but already you could begin to see that the situation was starting to slip away. The Taliban was beginning to reassert itself in the Pashtun areas, some Pashtun areas of the country. And then I would argue that in response, we as a country made a huge strategic error. Back in the beginning, when I wrote that paper for George Tenet and the Principals Committee, what we said was, look, we will be making a huge mistake if we appear like invaders, and even more so if we appear like occupiers of Afghanistan. If we are to prevail here, Afghans must be in front. We have to support the right parties, but at the end of the day, it's Afghans that have to achieve this victory. It's Afghans who have to lead this victory. We mustn't give any indication that we're looking for permanent bases. Afghans in front, Americans behind. And in 2005, we forgot those principles. This became an American war. We decided, in effect, that Afghanistan was too important to be left to Afghans. We had 100,000 American troops at the height, an additional 40,000 troops from NATO. We were spending $100 billion a year. We completely overwhelmed this small, primitive, agrarian country with nascent national institutions. And now we can see the result with the U.S. withdrawal, the substantial U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan. And I fear that in the not too distant future, although the front lines of the global jihad have shifted, right now we're all focused on the so-called Islamic State in Iraq and in Syria. We're concerned about Al-Qaeda in Yemen, Al-Qaeda affiliates in Somalia and elsewhere. So the front line and the focus has shifted. And it may take a very long time to roll the Islamic State back. I feel fairly certain about that. But ultimately, they will be. These are people who, at the end of the day, will not have the support of the majority of Muslims. And the day may well come in the foreseeable future when they will be looking for another safe haven, and I greatly fear that they will find it in Afghanistan. And the mistakes of the recent past will come back once again to haunt us. Peter was very kind a few minutes ago. He didn't mention just how long it took me to write this book. In fact, Peter, I think you were the first person I ever talked about writing this book with, just after I left CIA in 2006. And you know, I'm glad that I didn't write it then. Because if I'd written it then, it just would have been an adventure story. And frankly, that is the heart of the book. I still kind of see it as an adventure story. But it's an adventure story that's bracketed in a much larger story. The story of how we won the first American-Afghan War, how we lost, or at least certainly didn't win, the second American-Afghan War, and how the errors of the past may yet be revisited when once again we may be called upon to fight a third American-Afghan War. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rob. Well, that was great and a very sobering kind of conclusion. And I guess, you know, just going to the conclusion, I mean, it seems to me that the 2016 deadline is very caught up with President Obama's, you know, basically promises to himself and to the American people about ending America's wars. Mm-hmm. And it, you know, not coincidentally, the withdrawal coincides almost exactly with his departure from office. So I think, is it conceivable, that Hillary Clinton or whoever wins the Democratic nomination, or Jeb Bush, or whoever wins the Republican nomination, maybe even on their platforms, would say, actually, you know, it's not such a good idea. We've already run this movie before in Iraq. Look what happened. Mm-hmm. Why would we take the risk of this happening again in Afghanistan when we know what, you know, what one possible outcome could be from this, which doesn't look that great? I mean, to me, it seems fundamentally irresponsible to be talking about this December 2016, we'll turn the lights out and go, because most Afghans want us to stay, as far as I can tell. Mm-hmm. I think our Pakistani friends don't want Afghanistan to just collapse into some sort of civil war. They don't want the Taliban to come back and rule in Kabul. Mm-hmm. So do you anticipate that there will be, you know, I mean, we have a strategic partnership agreement with Afghanistan going till 2024. Mm-hmm. We have the, so it's already in place. You know, this is just a, so do you anticipate that there will be changes in this policy?
Well, the concern that I have is already, I mean, you can talk about 2016. I'm concerned right now with the absence of U.S. combat troops, that having made what I regard as a grievous mistake and having tried to do too much from 2005 onward, now we are compounding that error by trying to do too little.
Yeah.
And I think part of the difficulty for us and domestic politics, which other people in this room understand a whole lot better than I do, plays into this in a way, because Americans are not used to fighting partial wars. They're very unsatisfying. Americans, if they're going to fight a war, they want to go in and they want to win, and then they want to get out.
They don't want to do long wars, that's for sure.
They don't want to do long wars. Certainly not open-ended wars. President Obama, when he made that famous second rollout of American policy in Afghanistan on December 1st of 2009 up at West Point, he made it very clear. He said, we will not engage in an open-ended struggle, an open-ended nation-building operation of 10 years or more.
By the way, was that kind of, I mean, there was a huge mixed message. If you go back to that
day. Oh, yes.
Because I remember being at CNN, you know, the crawl at CNN even before the speech, because we have the speech was, you know, we're going to pull out in 18 months. So, you know, he announced the surge and the withdrawal at the same time.
Yes.
Was that too clever by half?
That's the way I looked at it.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I'm not opposed to this administration. I'm not politically motivated here, but I've been quite harsh. In fact, in the book, I'm quite harsh about that decision and the way that he did it. And I describe it there and believe that this was essentially an exercise in misdirection, that he didn't want to say no to the military, didn't want to be seen in the context of domestic politics to be saying no to the military. And so basically he said, go ahead, knock your socks off, but you get in 18 months. Mm. And they knew that this was not enough time to do what they were setting out to do. Now, mind you, I would not have launched that surge in the first place. I thought it was the wrong way to go about
it. They did blunt the Taliban momentum.
It did, but they were making gains which were foreseeable, but it was also just as foreseeable that those were gains that could not be sustained by the Afghans themselves.
You know, at that time, before the surge announcement, there was a kind of a debate within the Pentagon, and there was one kind of group who said, go long, go light. And you know, looking back at it, that might have been the smartest, because I think one of our problems has always been telling the Afghans, hey, we're gonna be here, but actually we're only for 9 months, or or whatever.
Right.
I mean,
right.
Everybody sort of wants us to kind of establish that it's a long-term thing, that we're not gonna turn off the lights, but they don't want this heavy footprint.
Right, so to get back to answer your question, could there be a change in policy? Absolutely there could, particularly if Islamic State gets a foothold in Afghanistan, we begin to see this in a whole different light, depending on what happens elsewhere in the global jihad. But again, we may see a change in policy, we may see a larger American footprint, but I'm still not at all confident that we're gonna do it right. And if you had to sum it up in a phrase, I think the phrase that Peter used is just right, go long and go light. I think that we need to be focused on a sustainable effort in Afghanistan. The United States is a large and powerful country. I mean, if we can do things for a long period of time, provided that what we're doing is actually sustainable. The surge in Afghanistan was simply never sustainable. So I think that we ought to have two objectives. One is to make sure that the government in Kabul cannot be overthrown. And I think a major component of that is training and equipping a small, sustainable but effective Afghan army, but not pretending that we're ever going to be able to create an Afghan army that's going to be able to occupy the country and actually control it militarily. No conceivable Afghan government will ever have the resources to do that. So I think that we need to be helping Kabul to engage in counterinsurgency within the ambit that it can properly control, and aid other elements in insurgency against the Taliban in areas that are beyond the ambit of Kabul. Now, you're not gonna have as many allies as you want. You're not gonna have them where you want them. You're not gonna have them when you want them. So the effort has to be opportunistic, and I think it has to be open-ended. But nothing is static in Afghanistan. And eventually, the Taliban is gonna understand that, you know what, we're not gonna prevail in this war. Now, do I think that there's ever gonna be a peace agreement? Do I think we're ever going to see a coalition government, including the Taliban? No, I don't. I don't think that they are capable of it, frankly. I don't think that's their mindset. These are absolutists. They're fundamentalists. And my thinking has been influenced by Mullah Zaif, Abdeslam Zaif, who was the Taliban, one of the founders of the Taliban, Taliban ambassador in Pakistan when I was there. And I've had opportunities to speak with him since. Had some very interesting conversations. And he says, you know, we shouldn't be doing what we're doing. It's not because he's opposed to the Taliban, far from it. But he says, we should not be engaging in politics. Mm. We are a social force. Mm. We should be there to make sure that whoever is in power is appropriately adhering to Islamic precepts. Mm. That, I think, is ultimately
going to be the goal of the Taliban. That's interesting, because that's really where they were coming from and I think that was really a genuine impulse at the beginning.
That was an impulse, and like a lot of people, they fell victim to mission creep.
And power.
Yeah, right.
Going back to the Taliban, because I mean, one of the, you know, I've talked to Bob extensively about this, and it's really, I think, a really, and it's obviously a very important part of your book, But this negotiation with Mullah Usmani is really critical because I think history could have turned out very differently. I mean, Mullah Usmani, tell us about who he was. Mm-hmm. He obviously came with Mullah Omar's blessing. You had a real serious conversation with him about handing over bin Laden. He didn't say that's a ridiculous idea. So tell us about that.
Yeah, shortly after 9/11, I'd been in regular touch with the deputy foreign minister of the Taliban, Mullah Jalil. And he was not a CIA source, I can tell you that, but we were talking back and forth via satellite phone. And I think he was a very, very clever fellow. He still is, I guess. I don't know whatever happened to Mullah Jalil. He disappeared from view. But he was a very clever fellow, and he wanted to see if he could find some formula that would get Afghanistan out from under UN sanctions, that would somehow square this circle. And shortly after 9/11, I got a phone call from him, and he said, would you meet with us? And I said, absolutely, I would. And I was very encouraged by the fact that the person who was going to be accompanying him was Mullah Akhtar Muhammad Usmani, who was the Southern Zone commander for the Taliban. He was the de facto, he didn't have the title of being the number two within the Taliban, but de facto, he was the number two figure in the Taliban, very, very powerful figure. And somebody who we knew from our intelligence, which was actually quite good, that he personally did not like bin Laden, didn't personally like al-Qaeda. And al-Qaeda had actually a lot of enemies within the Taliban itself. Mm. And there were a lot of reasons for that we could catalog. And we knew that Mullah Usmani didn't like them. So I was tremendously encouraged by this. I said, aha, he's the one person I really want to talk to. A, he can actually do something, and B, he doesn't like them. So we met in a hotel in Quetta, and he explained to me at the outset that Mullah Omar knows that we are here. He has sanctioned this meeting, and he has asked us to see if we can come to an arrangement with you. And he made it very clear that he could agree to nothing. I made it clear that I could agree to nothing, but at least we could come up with perhaps some way of solving this problem that we could then go and present to our elders and betters. And Mullah Jalil was the note taker and the witness for Mullah Omar. And we had a very interesting conversation. And at the outset, you should read it. At the outset, he said, we don't like this man, bin Laden. He's a problem for us, as we know he's a problem for you. We need to find a way that we can solve this. I thought, well, now we're talking. Hmm. So I said, okay, how do you propose to do it? He said, well, what do you think? So I laid out a range of different options that I thought might satisfy Washington and solve this problem for us. And all the way down the list, he cataloged him. He said, nope, that won't work. So finally, in frustration, I said, well, okay, what do you propose? He said, well, we'll take your ideas to Mullah Omar, and we'll see what he decides. A couple of weeks later, we met again. This time it was on the 2nd of October. And by this time, Mullah Omar had come out and made it very, very clear he was not going to turn his back on bin Laden, despite the fact that he had an excuse to do so. The ulama, about 7,000 religious scholars, had met at his invitation in Kabul. And they came out with a rather sly response, because he said, tell us what is the Islamically correct thing that we should do about bin Laden. And they said, well, we shouldn't expel him, but he should leave. So he at least had the thin edge of a wedge there. I thought if he wanted to turn that to his advantage, he could. If he was looking for an excuse to turn on bin Laden, he absolutely refused. So when I met again with Mullah Usmani, again in Quetta on the 2nd of October, I said, look, Mullah Omar has in effect declared himself a permanent enemy of America. Will the rest of the Taliban join him? And we went off on a long conversation, and like most of our conversations, it was very circular. And in the end, he was in despair. It was amazing. I mean, he's a physically imposing man, huge man. Tough, gruff, obviously the full Taliban beard. This is a warrior.
Didn't you offer him some advice about how to do a coup?
I did. And he was cornered. I could see him shrinking in front of me. He realized that his leader was not going to back down. He realized the Americans were undeterred, that we were going to be coming. And he had a very bad feeling about the future, you could tell. And he took off his turban. I'd never seen a Pashtun do that outside of a family. So he took his turban off, laid it aside, and he said, what should I do? So I said, look, you've just said Mullah Omar is bound by a promise to bin Laden. You are bound by no such promise. You are the one person within the Taliban movement who can push Mullah Omar aside. Nobody's saying that he should be hurt. But you need to push him aside, you need to hold him incommunicado, and you must do, to save your movement, to save your country, what he himself cannot. And years before, I had read, you know, Coup d'etat by Edward Luckvat. And I could just see all the different elements. He laid out, you know, what do you do, you know, traditionally if you have a coup. So I just went down the list.
Take the radio station.
Critical. You know, seize all of the ministries. Make sure you have your soldiers in all of the major intersections. Make sure that they are there. If there are any forces that are not under your command, you must neutralize them. But critical, take over the radio station and announce what you're doing. Say you're following the dictates of the ulama. After all, they were the ones who empowered Mullah Omar, and now you are carrying out their orders where Mullah Omar will not. And then you have to go off and seize bin Laden, and you have to catch the 14 other people that we said you must catch, and et cetera, et cetera. And he said, I'll do it. But first, I will bring your proposals to Mullah Omar. Oh my God, here we go again. Okay, fine. But Mullah Omar is going to say no. And then you have to seize power. He said, I'll do it. And it was like a huge weight had been lifted off his shoulders. I mean, in that time, it was kind of like Bill Clinton. When he said it, I think he meant it. And he jumped up out of his seat, and he wrapped me in a hug. And then we went off and we had lunch. And he was buoyed by this. So there was something else, though, that I knew and that I couldn't tell him, and that is that the bombing was going to start in 5 days' time. It was going to start on the 7th of October. All I could say was, hurry. And so we had a series of conversations before the bombing started, and I said, you know, are you going to go ahead? And he said, I'm thinking about it. Have you spoken to anybody else? Are you talking to anybody else within the Shura to help you? He said, no, I have to do this on my own if I'm going to do it. And we arranged a call for the 7th of October. And the day came and went, no phone call, the bombs fell that night. We spoke the following day. He was not in a good mood. In fact, I remember he started shouting at me fairly soon after the conversation started. And a couple of days later, we spoke again. He said, I can do nothing until the bombing stops. And that was the last time that we spoke. So, I mean, at the end of the day, and some of you may have seen an article, an excerpt from the book that appeared in the Atlantic Online, and you're sort of suggesting that if only we'd given this a little bit more time, that maybe it would have worked. I like to think so, but in fact, if I had to bet my federal pension, I would say no. And in fact, in the cable that I wrote right after my meeting with Osmani on the 2nd of October, I said, you know, he had conviction when he said that he would do it, but in the end, I don't think he will. And the reason that I gave was that I thought he lacked imagination. Hmm. I didn't think at the end of the day he could see himself in this kind of a role.
What about the related question, which is, you know, there were a lot of Taliban who seemed to want to surrender in the early December period to Hamid Karzai, and then they were excluded from the bomb discussion. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean,
yes.
How history might have been different if...
I think history might very well have been different if, you know, not only, you know, we, the U.S. government and the international community had a different and more realistic attitude. I think Lakhdar Brahimi, who played a key role for the UN in all of this since, has said, you know, we should have taken account of the fact that the Taliban was not going to completely go away. They were a social movement. They had a certain sway. But there were two major factors. One was that, you know, we were fighting a global war on terrorism. And these people had allied themselves with the terrorists. How were we going to make them a part of the solution? And secondly, I think our victory was deceptively easy. And having been terrified at the outset that we were going to end up in a very, very bad place, that we were going to be fighting in an open-ended guerrilla war in Afghanistan, no clear objectives, no clear enemy, that ultimately we would end up like the Soviets, when it turned out quite differently, I thought, well, you know, maybe I shouldn't have worried. You know, maybe they really are a spent force. Mm. And in fact, I do think that they would have been a spent force that had, you know, had Afghans been wiser, had we been wiser, that a new political dispensation could have arisen in Afghanistan, which would obviate the need for a Taliban, or at least for obviate the need of a political role for the Taliban.
By the way, I've spoken to Dr. Abdullah and in the past, and I've asked mm-hmm. him, what could you live with? And this was a conversation many years ago mm-hmm. in terms of a Taliban. Mm-hmm. And he's, you know, perfectly happy with Taliban district governorships, even provincial governorships.
Right.
I mean,
right.
I agree with you. For them to be like playing a big role in a coalition government, I don't see that. But there's, yep. yeah, I mean, in parts of the country, mm-hmm. there's no reason why they shouldn't engage in conventional politics, but they don't seem to want to mm-hmm. do it.
No. I mean, their sights are far higher. Right now, yeah. And I think it's going to take some time to lower their sights.
So you spent a lot of time with Hamid Karzai. When he came into office, mm-hmm. After the Bonn Agreement, he was the world's greatest human being.
Yes.
He leaves office as the world's worst human being. Neither of these things can be simultaneously true.
Right.
So tell us about the Hamid Karzai that you knew. Did he change over time? Did we, too many rose-colored spectacles initially? He doesn't really deserve the blame that he's been heaped mm-hmm. on now. What's your view?
Yeah, mind you, I wasn't able to watch the evolution of Hamid Karzai firsthand. So I met with him again on that trip that I mentioned in 2005. I left CIA in early 2006, and you know, since then, all I know is what I read in the papers. But I have a lot of sympathy for Hamid Karzai. I think that he is a fundamentally well-intentioned individual. Even in the days when I was dealing with him, he was jarringly mercurial. Hmm. I mean, he tended to follow the advice of the last person to whisper in his ear. And so the trick was to be the last person to whisper in his ear. And legitimately, he was in a very difficult place.
Yeah.
And as he was going through his negotiating process, you know, with the Taliban, and he was talking on the phone with all of the leading members of the Shura, but he's got the Americans over his shoulder, and the Americans are implacable. You know, no negotiation with international terrorists, and so that, you know, de facto excluded the whole leadership of the Taliban with whom he was negotiating, and so he had to be very, very careful that he wouldn't lose the support of the Americans and of the international community. But he also understood Afghan politics, and I think he also understood instinctively that we do not want to be engaging in urban warfare in Kandahar, and we didn't have the forces for it, for one thing. Mm. And Hamid Karzai himself probably only had, I don't think he had any more than 350 fighters with him at any given time. Can you imagine? Mm. So essentially, he was a lightning rod for the U.S. Air Force. He really was. Gulag Sherzai actually had
Well, he narrowly survived being killed by the U.S. Air Force.
And then, yes, his friends very nearly killed him at the Battle of Shawali Kot, just north of Kandahar, and in fact, on the very day that he negotiated the quote-unquote surrender of the Taliban. Gulag Sherzai, on the other hand, did have a substantial force. He had about 1,500 fighters, although he's sort of a footnote to history. So I think Karzai was the right figure to turn to. I think he was a unifying figure. He legitimately was somebody who wanted to unify the country. He was able to build bridges, always had tried to build bridges to other elements in Afghan society, and I think that it was important that you had a Pashtun in that position.
Yeah.
But over time, living with the United States could not have been easy. I mean, essentially, and this is no reflection on Karzai, this is more of a reflection on us, he essentially became a puppet. And the fact that the Taliban would not talk to him, the fact that the Taliban was willing to talk to the Americans about the conditions under which they would withdraw from Afghanistan, but they wouldn't talk to Hamid Karzai. That must have been excruciating for him. Mm. We don't want to talk to the puppet. We want to talk to the puppet master. Mm. And so he was essentially powerless in his own country. And I think that was very, very difficult for him. And I can understand why he developed the animosity toward us that he had by the end.
One quick final question before we open it up to the floor. Were you aware that bin Laden was at the Battle of Tora Bora in real time?
No, I was not. I could see I was sitting in Islamabad, and Gary Bernson, who was the head of Team Juliet that was up in the Tora Bora area around Jalalabad, they were working with Afghan militias to try to hem in these al-Qaeda fighters that were up there in those mountains on the Afghan side of the Safed Koh. And I could see some of the message traffic that was coming through. I knew that they were convinced that bin Laden was there. Precisely what that was based on at the time, I didn't know. I read what you all have read. And of course, I've read about, you know, the intercepted radio transmissions, et cetera, et cetera. I think that this whole period is still wrapped in a lot of mystery. And I know that area. I've seen it. I'm not sure that a battalion of U.S. troops would have helped you to catch bin Laden. You could lose a whole battalion of
U.S. troops.
But
it wasn't tried.
In one of those ravines. And no, it was not tried. What I think might have been effective would have been if you could have airlifted a significant number of U.S. Rangers up into the high passes. And there were five passes that we identified that we thought the Taliban, rather the al-Qaeda, was most likely to flee through.
You mentioned working with the ISI. That was a pretty close relationship at the time.
It was. It was a very close relationship at the time. And it was through my cooperation with the ISI that the Pakistani army set up tripwires on their side of the mountain passes. Turned out they weren't all that effective. It was tribal Lashkars on, you know, much further down in the valley below who actually captured a lot of these al-Qaeda fighters. But they captured about 130 of them. And so I think that is an effort was a relative success. But of course, they didn't capture bin Laden. And to this day, I don't think we really know exactly how he made his escape.
I think WikiLeaks is useful on this. He went into Kunar. So he did something very unexpected. He didn't go into Pakistan. He went into Kunar.
That was
a very smart way to do it. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, questions, if you can wait for the mic, identify yourself.
Yes, my name is Joel Hetker. I was a Peace Corps volunteer in Iran, made two trips overland to Afghanistan in 71 and 72. It's a long time ago. Now, I have a couple of questions.
I wish I could have done what you did.
Yeah. Right. Question one, in the 1950s, there was talk about a Pashtunistan to be carved out of Afghanistan and Pakistan. It didn't go anywhere for whatever reasons. And the
Pakistani opposition had a lot to do with it, I suspect.
Second question would be the Shenwari in Jalalabad. I thought we signed a treaty with them. Did we do anything with the Mangal as another tribe?
I'm sorry, that we signed a treaty with the Shenwari?
In Jalalabad, we signed a separate treaty with them. Is that true?
I'm not, maybe somebody else can help me on this
Andrew
one.
Wilder.
I'm not aware. Yeah. I mean, I think the concept of dealing with legitimate tribal forces in different parts of Afghanistan who are loosely at best affiliated with Kabul is probably a wise one. Yet one has to be very, very careful about it. So I'm not opposed to that sort of thing in principle. I'm sorry, the first part of your question was. Pashtunistan. Well, you know, it's really interesting. You'll see in the book. I had this when I had a long conversation with Hamid Karzai in the spring of 2005. It was not a very focused conversation. Hamid was being Hamid, frankly, and you know, he spent a lot of time talking about just that. If you hadn't known better, you would have thought that, you know, at any given time, if only he desired to do so. That he could have, you know, taken all these areas and moved the Durand Line to the Indus River.
So Andrew Wilder over there, and yeah, the Pashtunistan, Andrew, correct me if I'm wrong, also was more of a sort of secular, even Marxist kind of idea. There was the Red Gandhi,
yes,
who was leading it, and it wasn't a Taliban-like idea at all.
That's absolutely right, and of course, you know, true Islamic fundamentalists don't believe in dividing Muslims. they want to unify Muslims, and so they're not interested in a Pashtunistan.
Thank you very much, Andrew Wilder, U.S. Institute of Peace. I wanted to come back to one of your earlier remarks about your first memo and trying to highlight the fact that this was primarily a political issue, and just sort of trying to find hard military targets to bomb was really not the solution. But I was wondering if you could build on that a little bit more, because I think what's always struck me is, I mean, I've never did figure out what our political strategy was in Afghanistan. And we always had a military strategy, or then we had a coin strategy, or a CT strategy, and then we had lots of development money. Mm-hmm. But to what political end? And it seemed to me, including with a lot of the agency work, bags of cash sort of became the strategy. Mm-hmm. Short-term buying off allegiances, maybe buying some intel, but very tactical level, but was clearly undermining the longer-term objective of trying to build a more credible and legitimate government. And ultimately, it was this corrupt and predatory government, which is probably the biggest driver of the insurgency. And yet, a lot of our own policies, including the rearming of the largely discredited jihadi leaders in the very early days, which seemed to me, again, tactically would make sense to defeat the Taliban in those first 2 months. But then, okay, you've used them to achieve that objective, then let's discard them, because that was one of the few popular things the Taliban did do, was actually get rid of all those jihadi leaders and disarm most of them. Mm-hmm. And we very effectively rearmed them and made very unpopular people powerful again, and they then took over and captured the government, which then is, I think, one of the big factors delegitimizing it. So I think this lack of a political strategy, if you could say a bit more about that.
Yeah, it's easy to be critical, and God knows that I've been critical mostly of others, somewhat less so of myself. But this is hard. Solution is really, really hard. And you know, you talked about the first proposal that I made. I said, well, look, you know, we need to start with Mullah Omar. At that time, Mullah Omar hadn't indicated that he refused to break with bin Laden. And so we make the offer to him. If he refuses, then we smash him. We hope to kill him. We came within 30 minutes of killing him in the first salvo in the war. And things might have been quite different. And I think I might have had a very different conversation with Mullah Osmani had Mullah Omar actually been killed on the first night of the war, as we hoped. We said, okay, well, if he won't, we hit him hard as an object lesson to the others. Then we try to reach out to other factions within the Shura. If they refuse, we hit them as well. We have to smash the Taliban. Then God knows, how do we put this whole thing back together again? And so we were absolutely in a tactical mode. It wasn't much of a strategy. We were making this up as we went along. You know, I was military. We were all just making this up as we went along. And absolutely, we were trying to empower warlords. Hamid Karzai really wasn't much of a warlord. Gulag Asherzai was very definitely a warlord from his day. I wish we'd been able to make more deals with more warlords in the early on. Hamid Karzai was very nearly killed. What would we have done then if we'd had no Pashtun allies at all in the South? So.
Mm-hmm. That made sense, and I'm sympathetic. Yeah. I would argue next 13 years, I think, is where the problem lies.
Well, I would argue that we did actually have a strategic. The U.S. government did have a strategic conception. It wasn't really articulated in the Bush administration. It was articulated pretty clearly by Obama at the start of his administration when they first rolled out their plan for Afghanistan in March of 2009. And the idea was that we were going to reinforce a highly centralized Afghan state with a centralized army and police force, and that they were then going to establish rule of law, they were going to establish gender equality, they were going to do development, they were going to control their own territory, et cetera, et cetera. And you simply couldn't do it. Certainly not on the kind of a timeline that we were willing to sustain. And so, you know, later on, you started hearing the U.S. military talking about, you know, Afghan good enough. You know, the good has become the enemy of the perfect. The perfect has become the enemy of the good. We just need to kind of focus on what's good enough. And I think that's really what we ought to have been doing from the outset. And what I was saying at the time was, and from early on, I actually wrote another paper when I came back from Pakistan in the summer of 2002, where essentially, I didn't use the phrase, but essentially what I was saying is we need to help warlords away from the center of power, A, to have a link with the center of power, and B, to be the best warlords they can be. to try to make them as accountable as we can possibly make them. And, you know, it's very interesting. You know, I'll just cite one thing. I don't know if any of you have seen a book by Mullah Zaif, My Life in the Taliban. And early on in that book, he talks about Ghulagh Akhshar-zai during the time that he was governor in Kandahar. And he actually praises Karzai. He was one of the two principal Pashtun opponents of the Taliban who threw him out and helped to get him 5 years in Guantanamo. And he came back and he said, you know, this was a man who really did many good things for the people. So was he going to be, you know, your poster boy for good governance in Afghanistan? Not likely. But with a certain amount of guidance and the right sort of people on the ground willing to engage, I think that we actually could have made a difference. And one of the things that I do describe in the book that we, as a government, you know, people naturally devolve to their comfort zone. CIA wanted to go back to doing what it does, which is collect intelligence and chase terrorists. You know, AID wanted to do what they did. Military wanted to do what they did. DEA wanted to do what they did. And nobody was bringing this all together in a coherent policy. And I could see it speaking to my friends in dinner parties in 2008 and 2009 and 2010, where they were all wrapped up in what their respective agencies' plans were. None of it came together, and Afghans themselves were always an afterthought.
Lady in front, or wait for the.
I have a question because what you were just talking about the agencies and the different groups not getting along. In the 80s, I did research for CIA operatives. I come from a CIA family. I was 84. I kind of got stuck in, my family went to the Monterey Peninsula Country Club, got stuck into the, I actually told Mr. North when I was still 19, I don't think the Iran thing's quite the best thing. Mm-hmm. And but I was like you, what you were talking about. And then in the 93, I dated Mike Doris, the FBI agent.
What's the question?
But my question is I noticed my friends, CIA friends, were very angry when I dated an FBI person. And my issue is, do you see that still a problem today? And also, I'm not gonna go into facts about 9/11. Mm-hmm. Did you see it a problem back then? Thank you.
Okay.
Right. Short answer. To your question is, you know, is the problem of interagency rivalry solved? The answer is no. Obviously, the relationship between CIA and FBI is one that particularly resonates with me because, you know, that's where we all lived. And I remember, you know, doing a lot. Peter mentioned I was head of training at CIA for 3 years, and one of the things that I was trying to do was to, you know, create among, you know, these young saplings, they had not yet become twisted oaks, to imprint in their brains that, you know, we must cooperate with the FBI, that they have their functions, a distinct function, we have our function, and we need to cooperate together. You don't have to worry about your turf. They do what they do, we do what we do, but we have to come together to do it. And I thought naively at the time that this was sort of a generational thing, that, you know, if we solve this with the young people, then they will pass it on to others, and that, you know, the millennium will come and everything will be great. Well, guess what? You know, it's just something, it's original sin.
I tell you what, Freud says the narcissism of minor differences.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's the way he describes it. And
right.
I think it explains a lot of human activity.
It really does. And the thing is, you could see young people coming up in the two organizations making exactly the same mistakes that their elders did. So it's a long way of saying that this isn't something you can solve all at once. It's like gardening. You got to keep at it all the time.
Gentleman with the glasses here on this computer.
Thank you. Fascinating book, Dan Deleuze, Agence France-Presse. Just if I could ask you to elaborate on two things that you already referred to, at least one of which, mm-hmm. one of them. The first thing is the book ends with you talking about the need for Western, international, U.S. financial support for the government. Mm-hmm. Can you just talk a little bit about that? Mm-hmm. And then you also talked about your fears about the country becoming a haven again for jihadists and possibly even Islamic State group. If you could just talk about how real a threat that is or could be.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, the first part of your question was?
Money.
Money, yeah. Well, absolutely. I mean, we should not forget that Najibullah, who is the last communist ruler of Afghanistan didn't fall in 1989 the way a lot of people thought he would when the Soviet military left. He only fell when the Soviets cut off the money. And in fact, he was doing quite well during the interim. And he was using money very effectively. You know, I think the gentleman just asked you about this whole idea about money and Afghanistan. And obviously, it's not a permanent solution. I mean, we always used to say you can't buy an Afghan, but you can rent him. And you know, obviously, that's not very sustainable over time. But it certainly worked for a certain length of time with Najibullah until the largesse stopped flowing. And the concern that I have, one of the main reasons I'm concerned about the withdrawal of foreign troops from Afghanistan is not so much their role in fighting, but frankly, their role as hostages. That at the end of the day, their governments are not going to follow through on their promises for financial support of the government unless they have troops on the ground that they have to protect. And so I'm very concerned about the international community, particularly with our gaze shifting elsewhere, essentially abandoning this regime. And I think that could have disastrous consequences. And that is linked to the second part of your question, and that is, well, could Afghanistan again become a safe haven? Well, I would say, if anything, the future threat of Afghan safe haven is maybe even greater than it was back before 9/11. We've got the issue with Pakistan right now. There are groups within Pakistan that are dedicated to attacking the regime in Islamabad, and they're not going to go away. And at the end of the day, if the Afghan Taliban is asked whether they should be allowed to stay and to benefit from their at least passive support, they won't say no. These people tend to see things in a very binary way. Is a certain course, is it dictated by Islam or is it not? And they won't turn their back on the people who are ideologically allied with them across the border, nor I believe in the future will they turn their backs on international terrorists if once again they come back to the region in any significant numbers, as I fear they will if their fortunes take a bad turn elsewhere. Supposedly, killed this recruiter for Islamic State in Helmand Province. Yeah, it's interesting. I think that this is really sort of a branding issue. We had this proliferation of Al Qaeda chapters that were really not organic to Al Qaeda itself, but these were people who were trying to brand themselves in a way that would resonate with the populations to whom they were trying to appeal. And I think that we're seeing that flowing back in the other direction now with Islamic State.
Gentleman here, next to.
Thanks. My name is Amin. I'm a master student at SAIS. And my question is, you mentioned...
Have you studied with John McLaughlin?
I haven't had the privilege of taking his class yet. You mentioned your last conversations with Malos Money being towards the beginning of our bombing campaign. And my question is, what have been the obstacles or the reasons why we haven't tried to reestablish those contacts with their senior leadership, perhaps 2007 onwards till today, to maybe help bring about a better end to this, maybe a negotiated settlement, or maybe see what the options are. And as far as I know, these efforts haven't been made, but perhaps they're just not publicly known.
Well, there's a lot that I don't know, frankly, about what has gone on in recent years between the U.S. and the Taliban leadership. And we all know about these sort of nascent deals that were made, and the Taliban was going to be allowed to establish an office in Qatar, and we were having discussions with the Taliban, which never seemed to get very much traction. And frankly, I never thought that they would. I felt that the Taliban was enjoying enough success in its resurgence, particularly in the Pashtun areas, that they were happy to talk to the Americans, again, to negotiate the terms under which the Americans would leave. But I don't think that they were ever serious about making peace. And to me, the most clear evidence of that was that they didn't want to talk to Afghans. They didn't want to talk to the Karzai government. And I don't think that things are much improved at this point, again, because they are in the resurgence right now. I think that their aspirations will have to be blunted for some period of time before they're going to begin to start to think seriously about other alternatives.
And by the way, every time they've done an agreement with the Pakistani government, they've reneged on it. We've had multiple agreements with the Pakistani government. So to talk about the Pakistani Taliban, the Afghan Taliban is two very distinct. I don't really buy that. I mean, this is a group that doesn't recognize the border. They acknowledge Mullah Omar as their overall leader. Right. And there are more similarities than differences. So, you know, I agree completely with Bob, unfortunately. It was always a pipe dream. We had, you know, one negotiation that worked about a very specific issue, which is Bo Bergdahl. But the Taliban, and Andrew Wilder is one of the world's leading experts on this issue here. You know, the big thing the Taliban never did is they never explained what their vision of Afghanistan, you know, what they wanted. You know, other than getting the Americans out, they never said, look, hey, we're willing to have X, Y, and Z in the Constitution or anything. I don't think it was possible to have a real negotiation. They weren't sort of, you know, Henry Kissinger's in waiting who were willing to do a deal. In the front here, this lady.
Hi, thank you. I'm interested in your thoughts on Mullah Omar continuing to be a linchpin for the Taliban. I mean, Zawahiri still maintains that Mullah Omar is the caliph. Multiple groups in the region still maintain that. What do you think his removal would mean specifically to the Taliban? What kind of impact that would have?
Yeah, it's hard to say just how important Mullah Omar still is. My suspicion is that he's still quite important indeed. I think he's very respected, and obviously no organization ever remains locked in time. And there's been an obvious evolution with the Afghan Taliban in virtue of the fact that they have so many commanders now, and they've been engaged in battle with the Americans, NATO, and with the Afghan forces for so long. And of course, you always have to look at Afghanistan district by district to really kind of understand what the dynamics are. But still, at the end of the day, I think that the authority of key figures is still important. And I think that just that the respect that Mullah Omar would have with it, in different circumstances where he was able to raise his head up and to operate more openly, I think that you would see a lot of support for him. Now, I just may be wrong, and frankly, it's dangerous to talk sometimes with people like me whose experience is in the past, because we tend to think of the world as sort of being frozen from the time that we were engaged. This may not be your father's Taliban, but I still think that Mullah Omar is a significant figure.
So would his removal be destabilizing, do you think, to the movement of the Taliban?
My suspicion is that it would be. And the reason I say that is because I learned a lot of lessons about the way that the Taliban worked during these 88 days. And one of my principal teachers was a member of the ISI who'd worked with the Taliban for many, many years. And I could see the fact that other members of the Afghan Shura seemed to hold Mullah Omar in a tremendous reverence. It's part of the reason why I was never able to really get traction at the end of the day with Mullah Osmani. But he explained to me something that I really didn't understand until he explained it to me. And that was that Mullah Omar was, yes, he was a very respected figure, and he was admired, I think, for his piety and for I guess that the strength of his leadership. Not a great thinker, but a very strong leader, but also somebody who was very, very clever at manipulating people in the context of Pashtun culture. And all of the other key members of the Shura, the senior commanders, the governors, ministers, there was a tremendous amount of distrust among them in dealing with one another. And so Mullah Omar was at the center. He was, and they all sort of had individual spokes that related back to him. And what I found, it was really interesting during the negotiations, and we had, we were talking to various people, and I was dealing with Mullah Jalil throughout the war, and he was trying to get people together to maybe talk to me and try to find a way out of this thing. They could never come to an agreement amongst themselves with Mullah Omar not at the center of it. Mm. And it was an amazing thing. And so I suspect, at least among the leaders of that generation, if you will, the same is probably true now. It'd be very, very difficult, if not impossible, for them to replace Mullah Omar. If he were to disappear, I think that the power equation within that organization would change considerably.
Mr. Gentleman.
Hi, Arturo Jimenez, UC Irvine. You talked about that at the beginning, that one of the you think that one of the key strategic mistakes that the United States made was in 2005, the U.S. just started doing too much and became perceived as an occupier. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering that once that threshold has been reached, is it possible to reverse it? And if so, how? You know, you talked about a little bit about that. Mm-hmm. Changing the strategy to light and long. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, you know, if you could talk a little bit more about that with, you know, this change of perception and focus on how mm-hmm. do you make sure that the Afghani government is not perceived as a puppet of the United States, mm-hmm. or more broadly, that the United States is not an obstacle to a political solution.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that there were certain watersheds. And the one that comes immediately to mind for me was December of 2009. President Obama was sort of a captive of his own rhetoric during the campaign. You know, we need to reinforce Afghanistan, the good war, instead of Iraq, the bad war. And if you looked at the plan that he rolled out in March of 2009, it was very ambitious, to say the very least. We were going to, you know, it was the three Ds. We were going to defeat, degrade,
destroy,
you know, do bad things to Al-Qaeda.
Dismantle,
right. And we were going to defeat the Taliban, and then we're going to do all of these other wonderful things, you know, for Afghanistan. And Afghanistan, at the end of the day, would look more like Ohio. Well, I thought at the time that was unrealizable, and he too concluded that it was unrealizable when he named a new commander in Afghanistan, Stan McChrystal, who went out and did his commander's review and said, "Oh my God, this is a whole lot worse than I ever thought," and was thinking that he was going to need 60,000 additional U.S. troops. We are told, in order to make sure that we're not defeated by the Taliban. At that point, the president said, "Wait a minute, this is not what I signed up for." So great, we have all of these very ambitious aspirations for Afghanistan, but when he saw the price tag, hang on a minute, we need to reconsider this whole thing. And I think that if in December of 2009, when he rolled out the new plan, if he had launched something, if he said in effect, "Go light, go long," and it focused on sustainability rather than this ill-fated surge, I think history might have been quite different. I don't know if that helps answer your question. But.
Thank you. Charles Hornbostel, Office of Afghanistan Affairs, U.S. Department of State. Mm-hmm. So we've talked a lot about what didn't necessarily go right and where mm-hmm. we are now, but mm-hmm. we are in the world that we're in. Yeah. So what, looking at how things are now, we have a government of national unity in Kabul now, we have President mm-hmm. Ghani, we have Chief Executive Abdullah. Mm-hmm. What needs to happen? What does the international community in the United States need to do to help this be a going concern? What would be your considered advice based on your experience of what we need to do going forward to ensure that this government continues? Talked about throwing money at the problem. Okay, we talked about mm-hmm. Doesn't need to be changed a timetable, but I mean on mm-hmm. the political front, we talked about mm-hmm. the political side. So on the political mm-hmm. side, what do you think needs to happen?
Yeah, I think, you know, obviously I think the U.S. needs to be engaged. And I don't know, I don't have insight into the relationship, for instance, between the current U.S. ambassador and President Ghani. I think that we need Zal Khalilzad. I think when Zal was the ambassador to Afghanistan, I think that he had it very right. He wasn't at all shy about getting actively involved, using American influence, you know, trying to get Afghans in different places, different times, different roles to answer the better angels of their nature. I don't think we should be shy about that. But at the end of the day, it's Afghans who are actually going to make this happen or not. And as I mentioned before, I think that the critical thing is that we continue to support the government in Kabul in a sustainable way. I think that, you know, frankly, much and others in this room can speak to this far better than I can in terms of U.S. reconstruction, that we've thrown away huge amounts of money. We have, however, seen small-scale, locally led projects that have actually worked extremely well. They take a lot. They're long. They're slow. They require patience. But I think that they are effective over time. Obviously, they can only be done in places where there's a relative security. But in those places where it can be done, I think that it needs to continue. With regard to the military, I think again we need to be focusing on sustainability for the Afghan army. You have to be in this for the long term, and we need to help them to control the territory that they can legitimately aspire to control. Unfortunately, that leaves out many areas in Pashtunistan. And I think in those areas, again, we need to be willing, in conjunction with the Afghan government, to help those who are willing to oppose Taliban domination in their small areas to engage in insurgency against the Taliban. It's not going to lead to a quick victory. Americans don't like playing for a tie, but over time things evolve. I think if we are there, we are engaged. We have an open-ended structure. We are sustainable, and we are opportunistic. That we can make a difference over time, and that eventually politics will find its own level, and Afghanistan will be in a better place and less likely. And at least areas that would otherwise be uncontested terrorist safe havens will be contested terrorist safe havens, and that's maybe the best that we can hope for.
My name is Michael Belanger-Caron from the University of Montreal. I was wondering if, you know, you were talking about how it was important to vet a Pashtun before the start of the war. You were mentioning many names like Karzai, Osmani. I was wondering if vetting Massoud was ever an option, either for the CIA or...
Well, he was dead. Okay. So, not really.
He died. Okay, he was already dead before the bombing started, yeah. Before the... Okay.
Yeah, he was killed by terrorist bombing.
And my other question is, do you consider drone strikes a force multiplier for the counter-terrorist missions that you are implementing, or more of a strategic liability? That's a question.
Yeah, I think drone strikes are both, and it gets back to this whole issue of long-term strategic changes and short-term tactical issues. And it's very easy, particularly from me from an armchair, to say, well, these using drones in the way that they have been used in the Pakistani tribal areas has created more enemies than have been removed from the battlefield, and we need to be judicious. But at the same time, I can fully understand that, from the perspective of the U.S. government, particularly the U.S. military, when these militants are crossing the border and they're killing your people, you have to do something about it. You can't just sit on your hands and say, well, do no harm. You got to do something about it. That said, and again, this is so much easier to describe than it is actually to do in practice. Mm-hmm. That said, I think we need to be judicious. And I think where we took potentially a wrong turn was in, rather than using drone strikes as a counterterrorism tool, properly so-called, there was a long time where you didn't want to be the number three person in Al-Qaeda. You didn't want to be the operational coordinator because your life expectancy was very, very short, and there were a series of them that were killed, captured initially and then later killed in drone strikes. But we then transitioned as the number of cross-border militants proliferated. We started using drone strikes more as a counterinsurgency tool rather than a counterterrorism tool as narrowly defined. And I think it was when we started using drone strikes in so-called signature strikes, striking against large groups of people who seemed to fit a certain pattern of activity, that the number of civilian casualties went up markedly. I think that's when we really began to turn the local population against us. And again, while I can understand the reasons for it, I think that we may just have gone too far. But again, it's easy for me to say from an armchair.
I'm going to group two questions together because we're running out of time.
Okay. First off, thanks for your service. Thank you. Clint Kappel, I'm a grad student at American University and a service member. Really just wanted to ask you over your experience, the relationship between a civilian agency and a military agency within the Department of Defense, kind of using your eight-page memo mm-hmm. as a launch point. You alluded mm-hmm. that you had recommendations for General Franks to take mm-hmm. in execution of mm-hmm. the early onset of the mission. Mm-hmm. Using that and maybe a little bit more on the strategic side, mm-hmm. how do you see the gap between civilian and military organizations? Do you see it widening, remaining the same, or maybe those agencies are getting a little bit closer on recommendations mm-hmm. and work practices?
Okay, and this gentleman here.
Mike Duffin with the State Department. I know you've made the point that you no longer work for the agency, but based on your experience working in Islamabad, has anything changed with Pakistan in terms of what they do and don't do in Afghanistan?
Yeah, well, to get to the first question first, at the time that I wrote the piece that I described, we were very much focused on the start of the air campaign and how should we marshal this. And the idea was that, you know, we wanted to use air power in a very targeted way so that we would hopefully first motivate dissident elements within the Taliban leadership to break with Mullah Omar and not to attack them right at the outset, and then ultimately try to empower Pashtun tribal elements to turn against the Taliban if, in fact, we had to go that far, as obviously very quickly we did. In terms of how we would conduct the war tactically, we were sort of making that up as we went along. I was very much focused on, as I would be, the CIA relationship with these Pashtun tribal leaders. And you know, I sort of had this vague notion that we would have small numbers of U.S. military that would be with them and their CIA political handlers, if you will, and particularly to marshal U.S. air power. But I didn't have there's a lot that I didn't know, frankly, but then about the special forces and how they operate and everything. So it was a huge and very rapid education for me as well. And I think that the civilian CIA and the military fell into our cooperative role very easily and very naturally. And you know, it's interesting, it's been my experience that when you look at different agencies coming together on the ground, things often work quite well. If they have a common notion of the objective and they're serious about achieving that objective, the pretending stops. CIA can't do what the US military can do. The military can't do what the CIA's institution has been able to do with the institutional relationships that we had with Afghan warlords, et cetera, et cetera. So everybody kind of understands what their lane is and how they need to bring their respective talents and abilities together to achieve a result on the ground. The problem is always back in Washington. So I think that there was a lot of restiveness on the part of Secretary Rumsfeld in the time. You know, why the hell are we depending on the CIA to do these things? Why don't we have these capabilities ourselves? Why do we have to wait for these guys to go in and link up with Afghan warlords? You know, why can't the U.S.? So, and it continued on. When I was director of counterterrorism, oh my God, you know, all the time that we spent, you know, coming together with you know, national war plans for the war on terror, and people arguing about, well, who should take the lead on what objective, on what role, when it was very clear who had the comparative advantage in these different aspects of the war. So it's usually the folks back in Washington who muck all of this stuff up. But my experience has been that folks on the working at the tactical level, you know, are usually able, again, when they have a common conception of the objective, to work very effectively together. So I don't know if that helps to answer your question. And
Pakistan,
role Pakistan, changing. Yeah. Have things changed? Well, you know, it was interesting. In the first 2 years that I was in Pakistan, we U.S. government at large had a very, very bad relationship with the Pakistanis. We had sanctioned them very heavily for 10 years, and of course they had tremendous resentment toward the United States. You know, we were willing to deal with them and support them when it was convenient to us, and then when it no longer was convenient to us, we would turn our backs on them. And obviously, there's a great deal of truth in that narrative, and I think that, you know, one of the things that I could see very clearly, even the time that I was there, when relations after 9/11 were actually quite good, there was still a tremendous amount of mutual incomprehension between the U.S. and Pakistan. And given the circumstances, the fact that you had militants within Pakistan who were playing an active role in Afghanistan, that the fact that the Pakistani government was perceived as not doing enough about that problem, the Pakistanis, you know, feeling that we were pushing them to do things, and we did manage to push them to do things that had very negative unintended consequences for them, and for which the U.S. had very little appreciation. So you can understand how, you know, during the decade plus since 9/11, there's a tremendous amount of mutual resentment that would build up over time, and unfortunately, in a number of instances, we've seen that spill over, and we've never really been able to speak honestly with one another about what our real objectives are and what actually drives our respective policies. And it, unfortunately, it has been ever thus. You know, they lie to us, we lie to them. You know, we want, in some way, we want them to lie to us. You know, I mean, back when, during the anti-Soviet jihad, when it was clear that the Pakistanis were developing nuclear weapons, we didn't want to hear it. So if we ask you the question, you need to lie to us so that we can continue on doing what it is that we need to do together. That, unfortunately, that dynamic has characterized U.S. relations with Pakistan for a very long time, and I don't think at all that we have we've outgrown it.
We recently had General Sharif on the stage here, sitting mm-hmm. in that chair, and you know, it seems to me that, I mean, the low point was 2011. For mm-hmm. Raymond Davis, the Bin Laden raid.
Yes.
Things seem to have normalized, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's much more normal.
Things are certainly better. And then the U.S. cross-border attack in Momand, which came up roughly around that time. Remember
yep.
that?
I think there were 13. They killed 24 yeah. Pakistanis. And, you know, a Pakistani military killed Adnan Shukrajuma, who familiar mm-hmm. to you, because he mm-hmm. was the American who was leading Al-Qaeda. Mm-hmm. They just recently. So I right. think things are on an upward. The lady over here has been very patient. She's our final question. We've almost run out of time. In the back, did you still have a question?
Oh, Polly.
Thank you. Polly Nayak, I'm an independent consultant, and I did want to congratulate Bob on a stellar effort. But I realize, having read the book, that there are Rashomon-type choices in the way you tell the story. Mm-hmm. One that really was striking to me was, in fact, the absence of the Pakistani context, the U.S.-Pakistani context, mm-hmm. which at the time seemed to inform both this U.S. sense of regional options mm-hmm. and the U.S. approach to Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. So I wondered, I realize you already commented briefly on how our relationship with Pakistan has changed. But what are some of the elements that, if you were telling the story from a U.S.-Afghan-Pakistani perspective, you might mm-hmm. have added to your account?
Yeah, first of all, I should say that I want to recognize, you know, Polly for her leadership, particularly in the 2 years before 9/11, when she was the mission manager at CIA for South Asia. She was the one who was giving my report card, and she was very tough, and I'm far more grateful for your toughness now than I was at the time. But you did an absolutely brilliant job. One of the things that I think I allude to in the book and probably don't elaborate on enough, and tell me, Polly, if this is kind of getting at your question, that the extent to which our obsession with Afghanistan, understandable as it has been, has sort of blinded us to the unintended consequences for a much more significant country in the grand scheme of things, which is Pakistan. And things that we have done in Afghanistan have further radicalized a country across the border where radicalism was already a very, very, very serious problem. Had it not been for you know, what we demanded of the Pakistanis and their at least limited willingness to accede to our demands, we would probably not have had a Pakistani Taliban. I'm not sure that we have had, you know, a holistic conception of our regional priorities as we've gone through this whole process. And one of the things that I highlighted was a conversation that I had early on. This would have been early spring of 2002 with a then relatively little-known major general by the name of Kayani, who knew he had great things in his future, where I was pushing him to send Pakistani troops into areas of the parts of the tribal areas where we had consistent reporting indicating that Al-Qaeda had taken safe haven. And at this time, remember, the Indian and Pakistani armies were literally toe to toe at the border. I thought, and both myself and my counterpart in New Delhi predicted that Pakistan and India would actually go to war, and I think they would have if it hadn't been for Rich Armitage. Mm. But I will never forget that conversation. General Kayani said to me, he said, look, we could do what you're suggesting. And if we continue to do it over time, it's very likely that we'll trigger a tribal war. Mm. And we've done that before. And we could fight a tribal war, and we will prevail. But I'm going to have to take three brigades off the line in order to go and do that. I said, I don't dare do this unless I'm prepared to deal with the consequences. The consequences very likely will be tribal war. I can't spare those three brigades from the Indian border. And you know, and his fears were well-founded. In fact, they did end up triggering a tribal war in South Waziristan. They had to occupy South Waziristan, and we know the rest of the story. They didn't want to reprise that same experience in North Waziristan, which has led to no end of trouble between our countries. So, I think that in pursuing this understandable obsession with Afghanistan, achieving our goals in Afghanistan, we have removed our gaze from the anticipated but still unintended consequences of our actions in Pakistan. Does that get anywhere close to answering your question?
That's very helpful, and the book was excellent in any case.
Thank well, thank you, everybody, thank for coming. We all want to thank Bob Grenier, and also he's going to sign books. So thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.